Good morning and welcome to any visitors. We are grateful for you to come here and be with us as we worship the living God. And so we are always thankful to have visitors here with us. We're currently studying through Psalm 23, if you will turn to that now. This psalm really has truly been green pastures and still waters to our souls. And so I'm grateful to the Lord, our shepherd, for leading us into this sweet place of his favorable presence. The author of this psalm is none other than the shepherd boy David, who would later become the greatest king that Israel ever had until the greater David was born in Bethlehem's manger. So David is really giving us a sheep's view of the shepherd. And so David's experience then in being a very good shepherd is rich for our own souls as we seek to understand what did he mean as he penned this song. And let me review what we've already seen in Psalm 23. We began, "The Lord is my shepherd." That's the foundation of this whole psalm, and everything that David has been building on is from that established truth. And so that God himself is my shepherd. And we are learning the way a shepherd cared for his sheep and took care of them. And it should be overwhelming our hearts that our shepherd is God himself. God himself is the one caring and taking care of his flock. And the result of that, David cries out, "I shall not want." If that's what I have, if I have a God who is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. I am cared for, fed, taken care of, protected. I have everything that I need if God is my shepherd. I shall not want. In the land of want, in the land of discontented hearts, the Christian flock, the people of God, are those walking around contented because of our good shepherd, our contentment that is found in him. What does he do? Well, he makes me lie down in green pastures. And last week we saw that sheep don't lie down if they're troubled. And so the shepherd has to do, we looked at four different things that he has to accomplish until a sheep will be able to lie down contentedly. And so God takes away all of our fears and our anxieties and the things that have us stirred up so that we can just lie down in this contented, sweet place with God being our shepherd. And then he leads me beside still waters, the place of nourishment. He brings me to the scriptures. He is living water. And I get up and I come and I get that fresh dew of the morning of dwelling with Jesus Christ, communing with the good shepherd, finding in this word a place where I meet him and I know him and I grow and I'm learning to love and just have relationship with this sweet shepherd, the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. This morning, we're going to take a look then at verse 3 in our psalm, if you'll look with me. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." And so this morning, we're going to learn more of the holistic care of the shepherd for his sheep, of why I shall not want. He just continues to be all-encompassing of how he nurtures and cares for his sheep. So give me the shepherd, and I have all that I need. Amen? Well, let's join our hearts together in prayer, and we will open up the Word of God. Father, we come before you this morning, and we acknowledge that there is a veil that has been torn in two. And what once said, "Keep out," now says, "Come with bold, confident access because of the work of Jesus Christ, the good shepherd who laid down his life for his sheep." God, we thank you that we can now dwell with you as children, or that we stand before you in your presence blameless with great joy. God, we acknowledge this is a supernatural, beautiful gift that you have given to the people of God. And so, Lord, we worship you this morning. We want to praise you. Who's a God like you? Who could be compared to you? For you have given of your Son to bring about this redemption and this salvation that we know and enjoy. God, we thank you that now you lead us to the place of being able to feed upon you, to feed upon the bread of heaven, to feed, to drink the living water. Father, our souls thirst no more, for we have found Christ, and he has quenched that longing and that desire to know the living God. He has brought us safely into your presence. And so, God, we are worshipers of you. We worship in spirit and in truth. Lord, I pray now that you will take these words and you will open them up. You will teach our minds and our hearts, that you will illuminate them by your Spirit now this morning, and that every heart would be blessed in a shepherd who restores souls and leads us into paths of righteousness. God, teach us, we pray. Let our hearts be humble and receptive. In Christ's name, amen. He restores my soul. This is really an interesting statement as I began studying it this week. If the Lord is my shepherd, and he's watching over me, and he's leading me to green pastures and still waters, it's just, that's so rich and beautiful what we've studied. Well, what could happen to my soul? It just kind of feels like Fantasy Island of everything I've been studying. It's like Little House on the Prairie laying down in these fields. I like it. It seems like a beautiful picture, maybe a day at the ocean. So what do you mean now he restores my soul? What could happen to my soul with the Lord being my shepherd? Well, he protects me from my enemies, and so I am safe from all alarms. I am now safe this morning from me, and next week I am safe when I go into the valley of the shadow of death, as Adamo just testified. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. This week I am safe from me, that my soul can actually get to a place that it needs to be restored, even when I'm a sheep in the Lord's flock. And so there's a peace that we can find. There are green pastures to lie down in, even when we're in the shadow of the valley of death. Even when our souls need to be restored, there is a sweet place that God has designed for his people. And so please hear this in case it's going by you. The Lord's sheep can want for nothing. They can lack for nothing. However, it will not just be this perfect little life without difficulties. Everything is just always working out. Everything goes according to my plan, what I want and what I desire. There'll be no problems or trials or pain or difficulties or depression of soul or discouragement or hard times. I'm just kind of going to float on this calm little stream all of my days. The white water river rapids are moving really fast and dangerous, and God is going to say, in that we can find peace. What is being offered in the psalm then is not serenity and calm and ease where peace is to be found, but this is peace in the midst of every season that God has decreed under the sun for our lives. He has ordained every detail of our lives. Lives that will have every twist and every turn, every high and stormy gale. We will have trials and afflictions and difficulties by the hand of the Good Shepherd. So the peace that's being offered to us in Psalm 23 is really in an unchanging shepherd who cares for his sheep. That this shepherd will bring peace in the midst of it. One of the testimonies in a couple of weeks is going to be John Collins, who I was at his house when it's been a year since his heart attack at 34. And so he gets this heart attack. Then the hardest part is he gets PTSD from it, and it's been messing with him greatly. Then they decide to buy a house and move, and his wife turns up pregnant, and they have a baby. That is not the definition for rest and peace. And he's testifying this year anniversary is, God brought me into the place of peace. I lived in this turmoil. I'm always looking and thinking, I got to do this, I've got to do that, and I've got kids and my business. And he just has all these constant things pressuring. And in the middle of all of those trials, the Good Shepherd led him to the place of this sweet peace and comfort in him. So what I'm getting at is, what we're offering is not just this life without trouble or affliction or testing or squeezings. That is not what we need to get out of Psalm 23. It's in the midst of all of those things that God is offering us himself and peace and just tranquility, really, in the midst of his sovereign will, in his decrees, in his person, in the finished work of Jesus Christ that brings rest for our souls. It will never be the green grass that brings the peace, but it will always be the shepherd that has laid down his life for the sheep. Amen? There's refuge and there's peace in Christ. And you get that, and you understand it, and you will be lying down in green pastures when everything that could go wrong is going wrong. And just this morning, as I walked in here, I had four testimonies of people going through great difficulties, and every one of them shared with me a peace that God was giving to them in the midst of battling cancer, to family problems, just peace, shalom, wellness because of the Good Shepherd. You're going to be like a tree by streams of water, and your roots will go down even in the dry, hard times, and you will be bearing fruit even in and out of season. This is where we want this psalm to take us. And it's happening in our midst in abundance, so we should thank God. What he's doing in our midst is beautiful. He's meeting us, and he's teaching us this, and he's leading us beside still waters. So let us for a moment then just consider the author of this psalm, David. David was a sheep in God's pasture, and he's marveling at it in Psalm 23. But as you read some of the other psalms that David wrote, what do we find there? Is it always Psalm 23 in David's life? He was a man who tasted defeat in his life. He won every military battle, and he lost a battle with his lust that brought down his every. After that, he loses, his family falls apart, all of these consequences that came as a result of his falling under temptation. We see that his body, in one psalm, he says, it wasted away under guilt and sin. I had sleepless nights. He said, my bed was dissolved into tears. I had times of hopelessness and times of despair. In Psalm 42:11, why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God. And so here's David. He had these moments of depression and battles and struggles and losses and victories. We see David many times downcast and dejected. We see him battling in his very soul in many of the psalms that he wrote. He was broken and he was disturbed within at times. So what this tells me is that God's sheep can become downcast of soul. God's sheep can become spiritually depressed. His sheep can lose heart and have battles with unbelief and have times of darkness. What do we see with David? In his psalms, he would cry out in transparency with a soul like that. He didn't put on a front and fake it. He came and shared the inner struggles of his heart in these psalms. He would be honest and transparent to the very shepherd of his soul as he wrote them. And then what we'd see in almost every psalm is that the Lord then would come and restore his soul through truth as he would meditate on who God was. So almost in every psalm, you could watch the progression of a man battling and struggling, and he would work through it, and at the end, he would be hoping in God and praising and worshiping him. I call that restoring of the soul. God would take this man who's writing Psalm 23, he restores my soul, and he tasted and experienced it on a perpetual, continual basis. And so because of the fall then and all of the effects that have come, sheep suffer and they struggle. Sheep are prone to wander, prone to leave the God I love. And so what we need is a shepherd who can lead us out of these pits that we will go into as a result of the fall and the battles that we live in, or we will die. So what I want to do is first look at what David was most likely thinking about as a shepherd and the sheep as he penned these words, and then make some spiritual applications to our souls that we shall not want. How should we think on this phrase that David is writing? So let's look first. In studying, almost every preacher, writer, and commentator all thought that David was talking about the same thing, so I feel pretty confident this is what David was talking about. Excuse me. A sheep could become cast down sheep, and I want to explain what that means. Is you would have a sheep, and he would look to lie down, and he was lying there. If the ground was kind of hollowed in a certain way, if they just got their balance a little off and rolled over too far, they're stuck now on their back, and this is called getting cast. They're cast. They get on their backs, and listen to this. Once they are on their backs, they are in big trouble. Sheep have no ability to get back up again. It's kind of like me when I fall over sometimes. It's just here they are on their back, stuck. There is no way for them to get back up on their feet. It's called a cast sheep. And it's a pathetic sight, lying on their backs with their little feet in the air, struggling to stand up, bleeding for help. A cast sheep is in a very dangerous position. And they're vulnerable to attacks from vultures. Vultures would just be waiting when they would see a cast sheep, I think, as the enemy is even with us. There's dogs and coyotes and cougars. It's a very dangerous position to be in when you are a cast sheep. And I will say definitely in the spiritual realm as well. So if the shepherd does not arrive soon enough, the sheep will literally just give up and die. Sheep are really quickly, they lose their will very fast. And they'll just lay there and die. So the shepherd is responsible to make sure that all of the sheep then are on their feet. If he is short one at the end of a day or any time during the day, the first thought I am told that would come to a shepherd, there must be a cast sheep somewhere. I've got to go and find them and go restore their soul. I need to go get them back on their feet. So how does this happen? How does a sheep get cast? Well, again, in studying this week, it was the fat ones that were dangerous. It was even the healthy ones, the long fleeced sheep, made you more vulnerable to being cast. And so when you would lie down, they would roll on their side, and the center of gravity with their body shifts so that the sheep turns on its back far enough, and now their feet can no longer touch the ground. And as it lies there struggling, the gases would begin building up in the rumen, and it expands, and what happens is it tends to cut off circulation to the extremities of the body, especially the legs. And I was told if it's really sunny that one of these cast sheep could die within a couple hours. And if it's cold and cloudy, they could last sometimes several days in this condition. Keller, that book I've been telling you about that many of you are reading, he actually said when he was a shepherd, this happened very often. He would find them, and you have to come when you find them, and you tenderly roll the sheep over on its side. And as you would do this, this would relieve the pressure of all the gases that were building up. And then you would lift them up on their feet, and you would straddle them, kind of like, you know, a little toddler when you're teaching them to walk. So you straddle them, and you hold her up, and then you got to rub their limbs to restore circulation back into the sheep. And it would take a little bit of time, and slowly the sheep would gain equilibrium, and then they would dash off to rejoin the other sheep, set free from all of their fears and frustrations and just happy to be a part of the flock of God again. Isn't that a beautiful illustration? I love it. And so it's going to be easy to apply this spiritually, and that's what I would like to do with the rest of our sermon, is what does this have to do with the Christian life? Well, we're so prone to get cast in our walks with God. We get kind of rolled over, and we just can't get up. We can't pull out of it. Have you ever had those seasons where you just can't snap out of it? You can't snap back? That old saying, just do it, it doesn't work. And now you're in this dry season and struggling, and it's a very difficult time in the Christian life. As a shepherd, I've experienced it, and I've seen it in the sheep many times. And you can get very downcast of soul and just a darkness that will come over. We can get so depressed of soul that we can't even get out of bed. There's times where the hardest part of the day is just to get out of bed because you're feeling so dark. Bunyan called it the slough of despond. There's times when I'm really struggling and I just can't pull myself up by the bootstraps any longer. And you're kind of wasting away as David said he was in that battle. So having a thought that, you know, you've never had before, where all of a sudden I wonder if my life insurance is paid up. The Puritans would call it the dark night of the soul. And so many of the saints will enter into seasons like this. And many things can cause it. It can be caused by sin. It can be caused by unmet desires that you have and just life isn't working out as you thought. You're feeling like you went off of God's path and I just can't ever seem to get back on it. A fear of the future. Sometimes it can be nothing more than God's providence of what he's going to teach you and grow you in that season. And the question then becomes, does God care about you in this state. If you're sitting here, even this morning, does God care about me? As I'm really just feeling so left alone and struggling and battling, and I just, it's just me, and no, it feels like nobody. Is he just tired of you? Like the enemy's whispering in your ear this morning? Is God kind of done with you and sick of you? What I want you to see this morning is that the Lord is your shepherd, and he has a compassion and a concern for cast men, women, and children. He is a good shepherd. And praise the Lord that his eye never misses a sheep. A shepherd can miss one, but it helps to be omniscient and to be able to see all. There's not a sheep that will ever get away from his notice or his gaze. He will always show up to restore your soul. And that's what David is saying here this morning. He restores my soul. He restores my inner man. He restores that inner well-being with God. My shepherd always leads me out of this place. He sets me straight again and gets those limbs rubbed, and then I can run back off with all the other happy sheep in the flock again. This phrase, he restores my soul, it's so beautiful. And in studying it this week, it can actually, restore can have two meanings in the Hebrew. The one is he can restore as in to return from erring. So I'm going off and erring, and God can restore me. And the other word for understanding of restore is that it actually, he refreshes my soul. And so when he restores me, he's refreshing the soul again. And all the commentators that I have, they all took it that it refreshes my soul based on context and how David is treating it. And so I was just looking around at some other scriptures. Listen to Psalm 23:4. That's a nice close one in context. And he says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. They refresh my soul, even in the valley of the shadow of death. Lamentations 1:16 has both these concepts. For these things I weep. My eyes run down with water. Here's a distressed soul pouring it out, because far from me is a comforter, one who restores my soul. And so here he is, weeping and broken and all that's going on. I need a comforter. I need one who will restore my soul, who will come and refresh my soul in this difficult season. Proverbs 18:4, the spirit of a man can endure his sickness, but a broken spirit, who can bear? Who can bear up under this broken spirit, this downtrodden soul? Who can deal with it? It's so hard to help someone whose spirit has been broken. I can go into a hospital with a body that has been destroyed and the spirit is still well, and we fellowship, and I leave that hospital bed just rejoicing in God, saying, that is amazing. But when someone's soul, their very spirit has been broken, it is the hardest thing I've ever dealt with, because they're so dark and downtrodden, and they need their souls restored. And I believe all of us know these times, do we not? They are great battles. Ones that, what I have learned, you cannot get out of yourself. It's not just work a little harder. That will not fix this problem. We lay there with our little feet in the air, just wrestling and bleeding, and we can't get up and we can't get out of the season that we're in. And we get disheartened so fast like a sheep that we would just lay there and die if it weren't for a shepherd and the body of Christ to come get us out of this cast condition that we're in. So praise God that the Lord is my shepherd. He comes to me in these seasons. He lifts me back up, and he gets the circulation going again to where I stand and I can run for joy again. I've journeyed with the Lord now for about 30 years, and I can testify that I've been cast several times. And the Lord has come, and he has restored my soul every time. I preach this with such confidence this morning. He will restore your soul. And whatever you're facing this morning, I want you to not despair. Why so downcast, all of my soul? Put your hope in God. Put your hope in the good shepherd. He will come and he will restore your soul. Every time I stand here this morning, because the Lord is my shepherd and he restores my soul. That is why we're having this series, because the Lord restored my soul on an airplane trip coming home. I pray, Southside Bible Church, for the application this morning, that you will not turn to other things to restore your soul. We have something so sweet and beautiful and rich in the Good Shepherd, and too many times we look to other things to restore our soul. And instead of this beautiful gift that will restore our soul, that is right and works, we'll go to these things that will only make your soul worse, darker. It won't work. I've been around long enough that, have you ever heard the phrase, a midlife crisis? I used to laugh at that. I thought, that's what unbelievers do. And then the longer I've been a shepherd and then getting old, it happens if you don't guard your heart. And you start to look, and you've kind of put all that time in raising your kids, and you kind of come to the end and say, why did I do that? And what was it worth it? And what my job? I put all my efforts in there, and now what difference does it make? They're going to fire me. They have no loyalty to me. And all of a sudden, this midlife crisis starts to hit, and believers have to fight this. And then they start thinking some lady 25 years younger will bring them more joy and peace than this godly woman who has delivered 5 of your children and given up her life and sacrificed and labored with you together for the name that's above all names. What a foolish thought. And so I just don't sit and look to stupid things that are empty, that are never going to restore your soul. Don't go after the get-rich schemes that if I could just get all this money, then everything would be great. I'm going to give my life to travel and to entertainment because that's what gives life to me. That will restore my soul. I'm just going to give some moral resolve. I'm going to work harder. I'm going to try, just give it everything I've got, and that's going to restore my soul. That will never work. I'm going to take drugs and prescriptions and just numb myself until I'm restored, and that stuff never works. I'm going to get accomplishment. I'm going to go get my master's or my doctorate, and then I will feel better about myself, and everything will restore. I'll have purpose. I'll have meaning, and we just keep looking thing to thing to thing to restore my soul instead of the beautiful shepherd that God has given us in Jesus Christ. Look to him, and I'll tell you, this will restore your soul every time. Every time. Turn to the Lord, who alone can restore your soul. I want you to listen to the writer of this psalm, and I want you to hear his testimony this morning. This is Psalm 32. David said, how blessed, how blessed, how envied, how happy of a condition is he whose transgression is forgiven. That means your soul has been restored, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. The blessed one is the one whom God will not take your sin and put it to your account, but he put it on the account of his son, put him up on a cross and crucified him in your place. How blessed is the man whose sin is put on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not put to your account. How blessed is the one whose spirit there's no deceit. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away. Through my groaning all day long, he was cast. For day and night, thy hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of summer. Selah, pause, take it in. I was deteriorating. I was a cast sheep. I was dying under this guilt of sin. I acknowledged my sin to thee. I turned to the Good Shepherd. I confessed my sin. And my iniquity I did not hide. I opened it all up before the God who knows everything. And I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Good Shepherd, the Lord. And thou didst forgive the guilt of my sin. He washed it away. He forgave it. It was as far as the east is from the west. I'll remember it no more. Therefore, let everyone who is godly pray to thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely in a flood of great waters they shall not reach him. Thou art my hiding place. Thou dost preserve me from trouble. You're my good shepherd. Thou dost surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you should go then. That's the paths of righteousness that we're going to look at this morning. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be as the horse or as the mule which have no understanding, whose trappings include bit and bridle to hold them in check. Otherwise, they will not come near to you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked because of their shepherd. But he who trusts in the Lord, loving kindness shall surround him. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous ones, and shout for joy, all you who are upright in heart. He restores my soul, and that leads me to my next point perfectly from what David wrote. Look with me in Psalm 23:3. He restores my soul, and he guides me in the paths of righteousness. It's interesting in learning about sheep. They are creatures of habit, which is kind of like all of us. You sit in the same places almost every week. Some of you mess me up a little bit, but I could almost put a little seating chart together and say, that's where they're going to sit, da-da-da-da-da. This is where they're going to park. They will follow the same trails until they become ruts. They'll just keep going through them, and they'll pound it down. They'll graze on the same hills until they turn them into a desert waste. Keller describes the first sheep farm that he had ever bought, and it was a land, and he said it had been sheeped to death. The shepherd had just left the sheep to their own ways. He bought a bunch of sheep. He kind of just let them go, and the result was an utter desolation of the land. The land had become completely impoverished and ravaged beyond repair, just because the sheep were not taken care of properly. They were left to themselves. They went their own way, as Isaiah 53 says, and it's like the world today. The world today is broken and desolate with sheep that everyone in the world wants self, and they're seeking self. And you know what? We live in just a wasteland. And if you're here today, it's ruining your life, your families, your friends, your jobs. You just look out, and all I see is a wasteland. Sin is deteriorating this earth. It's sheep that are going their own ways, and they're just destroying it because they're going this own path instead of the beauty of what we see offered to us in Psalm 23. The sheep gnaw the grass to the very ground until the roots are damaged, and then erosion begins in the ground. Their favorite spots are so well worn that they become infested with parasites. The land is ruined, and then the sheep become thin and sickly. So there was a safeguard for a shepherd to not let this happen. What they would do is they would keep the sheep on the move. Keep them moving. Don't leave them on the same ground for too long. Most of us hate this, that God does this, but he keeps you moving. And he brings trials of different circumstances. He just doesn't let you get in your rut that you want so bad. And he just keeps bringing it. And he moves you from pasture to pasture periodically. So there must be a predetermined plan of action for how a shepherd's going to rotate the sheep. And the owner's entire name and reputation depends on how effectively and efficiently he keeps his sheep moving onto wholesome, new, and fresh lands. His whole reputation is at stake based on how well the land and the sheep prosper. And so this took most of the shepherd's attention to keep moving the sheep. They would check daily the balance between the growth and the grazing pressure upon it. And if the maximum benefit of sheep to land is not being met, they would just move them on to a fresh field. So it took a lot of work, a lot of observation and attention. And the shepherd knows where his flock will thrive. Hear that. A shepherd knows where his sheep will thrive. He knows that well. And that's when David says, he guides me into the paths of righteousness. He knows where I'm going to thrive as a child of God, the way I live and in my life and all of those things. He leads me into that sweet place of righteousness. And we are stiff-necked and we are stubborn sheep. And we prefer to follow our own wants and our own desires. And we tend to look to our own understanding. And we turn to our own ways. The destructiveness of self-determination is ruining and killing many. Just being self-willed. We now have this good shepherd who will lead us into the paths of righteousness. And righteousness is the right paths. Rightness with God. Rightness with others. Rightness in the way we live. He will lead us into these right paths. Righteous. He won't let us keep doing the same wrong and destructive things that we did as the sheep under the devil, our enemy. Where we just kept plotting the same destructive paths and ruining our lives. That's how we lived when we didn't know the shepherd. And now this good shepherd is going to lead you to better lands, better grazing, better ways. He will guide us into the righteous paths. He keeps us moving into conformity to Jesus Christ. He will keep moving us. He who began a good work will complete it. And this good shepherd will keep moving us and leading us into righteousness instead of those old bad habits and paths that were destroying us in our Adamic nature. And so we looked at the Sermon on the Mount for a year as a church a year ago. And Jesus said, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. And here's the most externally righteous people on the face of the earth. And he's telling them, if you're not better than that, you're never going to get into this new kingdom that I have come to establish. So you need a righteousness greater than your own efforts, your own merits, trying to clean yourself up. That will never get you into the kingdom of God. Looking at the Ten Commandments and beating your flesh till you die will not get you into this new kingdom. You won't get righteousness that way. So the gospel comes with none of our own, when we will finally come and we hold out our hands and say, I don't have any of my own righteousness. I said this to someone this week. You've got to repent of your sin and your righteousness to be saved. You have to finally repent and say, I have none of my own. The best thing I can give God is a filthy rag. And now I come to you, God, with none of my own. And I look to Jesus Christ for all of his. And by grace, with an empty hand of faith, I will give you my son's perfect righteousness to your account, and that will bring you into the kingdom of God. And now once you're in the kingdom of God, now true righteousness is going to begin to reign because you have a relationship with God. And in this relationship with Jesus Christ, fruit is going to come out of it that's going to surpass the scribes and the Pharisees. It will be people living from the heart, people who love God and love others, and their lives are manifesting it. That is the true path of righteousness. We have relationship with him. We're adopted into the family. We get new hearts that love him. And Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. The sweetness and beauty of Christ shepherds us into the paths of true, genuine, real righteousness. He leads us into the pasture of God's love and love to others. He guides us into his commandments. He sets us free now to keep the law. He leads us into this beautiful, sweet place called righteousness. And I love that my shepherd keeps guiding me into the paths of righteousness, because I would stay in the same place and ruin the land just like sheep. I would just get stuck. And the shepherd just keeps nudging me, bringing me trials, giving me more desires in his word. It's just beautiful. I hope every one of you can testify how God is leading you into paths of righteousness. Keep being the same self-centered person I was for 20 years would be awful. There's a hangover from being in Adam, but the shepherd keeps leading us by his spirit to the paths of righteousness. Isn't that awesome? What a shepherd to keep leading us into these beautiful places to manifest him in this world. And so my question is why does God do that? Why would the Lord be a shepherd? I wouldn't sign up for that. They stink, they wander, they bawl at you, they're stubborn, they bite you, they fight. Who would sign up to be a shepherd? Why would God do this? Caring for us in the way we've been learning in Psalm 23 with so much provision and love, why would he do that? Is it because we're so cuddly and cute? Someone posted this week, and I already forgot who it was on Facebook, this little kid holding this little baby sheep. It was just the cutest thing I think I've ever seen in my life. And that isn't it. It's not because it's so fun to have sheep around you. The reason that God does this in verse 3, is he does it for his name's sake. His reputation as a shepherd is on the line by his sheep. It matters that we walk then in paths of righteousness, not because I feel better and it gives me a happy marriage. It's that God's name is at stake by the way I live my life for the King that is above every name. Let that sink in. Your well-being in his flock, the flock of God, is directly tied to God himself and to his own name. That's crazy. There's something that God loves even more than you. Though he loves you with a height and a depth and a breadth and a length that is absolutely unknowable, I'm not putting down the love of God, I'm exalting it. His love for you is linked to his love for his own name, for his own glory. And throughout Scripture, again and again, God always says, the reason I delivered Israel from Egypt was for my own name's sake. The reason I did this was for my name. The reason I do this for my name. I'm jealous for my name. I will not give my glory to another. God acts for his name. Everything in this earth is to bring glory to God. Everything is for his name. From him, through him, and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Why is this good news? Because what happens to you then, catch this, reflects upon the glory of his reputation. So whatever happens to you reflects on the glory of God's reputation. I would fail miserably without God. But because of his name, he will be glorified by his shepherding of his sheep and causing them to persevere to the very end and conforming us to the image of Jesus Christ. So you're tied to the very name of God. He is not going to let you be a sickly, destroyed sheep that goes into another fold. No one can snatch you out of my hand, Jesus said, the good shepherd. And so you are tied to the very glory of God and his name, that he wants you to be healthy, happy sheep, resting contentedly, wanting nothing, glorifying him in a dark, dying age. He wants his name to be great. And so it matters that his sheep are not sickly and dead, cast, laying down, needing to be restored. God cares. His very name is at stake. He will lead you, and he will guide you into righteousness. He will discipline you if you won't. He will shape you. He will mold you. He will guide you into these paths. That's a good shepherd. Of all that the Lord has given me, Jesus says, I lose none. No one can snatch them out of my hand, the good shepherd. And this should make you very happy this morning. Do you want your future tied to God's name and his promises? Or do you want your future tied to you keeping yourself lovable to God, being that cute little cuddly sheep? If that was the case, I'm done. I'm not cuddly and I'm not cute. There's no hope. And so I love that I am tied to God's name and his promises. And so get this. God's commitment to himself, to glorifying him on the basis of his goodness to us, is why he will shepherd us in the way that we're seeing in Psalm 23. So why can we trust him? Why shall we not want? Why shall we lie down in green pastures and drink from still waters? Why shall he restore our souls, and why shall he lead us into the paths of righteousness? For his name's sake. And I wish we were more excited about that answer. He does it for his name's sake. The way I live my life, the way that I trust and rest in Jesus Christ matters. That the world sees the shepherd and the beautiful blessing of being his sheep. And they want it. They want to get out of the devil's pasture and they want to get into yours, because you're blossoming and flourishing under the good hand of your God. And in that, God is glorified. The way that we live our lives matters. It needs to matter to you this morning because of the name of God, because the glory of God that it brings to the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this psalm. It just seems to get richer and richer with every nugget that we look at. And God, I rejoice today that I say every one of us, the only reason we stand this morning is because you restore our soul. God, many of us have tasted that dark experience that was described here this morning. And we can testify, Lord, that you restored the soul. And those who are in the dark night right now, Lord, I pray that the word of God would comfort them, that they would look up to you, that they would hope in you, that you are the one who restores souls. God, bring them back to what really matters. Bring them back to truth. Bring them back to yourself and you alone. Let them hope in God. Let that restore their soul this morning. And God, we thank you that you lead us in the paths of righteousness. We hate sin because we love the good shepherd so much. And I just pray, Lord Jesus, that you would keep leading us in the paths of righteousness. God, everything in our lives that doesn't conform or reflect your glory, we ask that you would remove it, that you would burn it out by trial and affliction. God, that you would burn it out through the beautiful, pure word of God. You would burn it out through sweet fellowship with one another, that you would burn it out by the communion table. God, all of these ordinances and graces that you've given to us, would you burn out sin and keep conforming us to the beautiful image of your Son, Jesus Christ. God, let everyone drink up the peace that the Lord is their shepherd this morning. Let it comfort every heart, no matter what they're facing. By your Spirit, would you speak peace to their mind and their hearts, even right now in their seats. God, we ask that you do what no human can do. Do that work in our midst, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.